Well, welcome, and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. The Apostle Paul wrote a letter to the church in Corinth. And those of you who have studied the Word, have been with us for a while, know that the city of Corinth had a renown around the Mediterranean as kind of the Las Vegas, probably worse than that, maybe the San Francisco, okay, of the Mediterranean. And oftentimes in any city around the Mediterranean, if you were a drunk or you were a recluse, something like that, they would say of you, you're acting like a Corinthian. That's how well known the kind of debauchery and hedonism that was enacted in Corinth. In fact, being a port city, it was well known as you made your way around the Mediterranean that you had to stop there. And it's kind of like San Francisco, or maybe like Las Vegas. There's a lot going on, kind of a lot of city life, but probably more pronounced than any other building or location in the city of Corinth is up on the mountain of Corinth. It's called the Acrocorinth. It's a mountain just behind the scenes of now the the archaeological dig of Corinth. Lucy and I have been there several times, and to stand in the city in the marketplace of Corinth, where Paul spent many a day debating kind of the Grecian philosophers, Stoic and Epicurean and other philosophies. Behind the city on this mountain stands at the very top of it this temple. And this temple was designed to be a place of worship, but not in the manner that we've just witnessed or that you would think of in this place either. Rather, this was a worship place where men would visit other men and other women for sexual encounters. And that was, to the Corinthians, a manner of worship. And in fact, because of that, the early church, the very young church, had began to meet in the synagogue of Corinth and later met right next door in a house next to the synagogue. They began to speak to the people of Corinth. Paul spoke to the people of Corinth about really beginning to live as Jesus lived. And now as he's received this letter, it seems that it's come from a woman named Chloe. He's responding to a number of questions in his first letter to the church of Corinth. And these questions have to do with just, in some ways, the policy or the manner in which church is done, but also in the manner and degree of arguments. And in chapter 5, an issue that seems almost phenomenal. It is rather phenomenal to Paul when he addresses what's going on there, because it seems as though in this church, this young church, mostly Jewish believers, but they're even in that, you know, that town like San Francisco, there are those that are coming to see Jesus and ask Him to be their Savior. And they're recognizing that there is freedom in Christ and that there is a great joy with being relieved of the burden of the things now they recognize by the Spirit of God were sin in their life. They're beginning to see that family is important
and as men previously without Christ were great abusers of their wives. To be a Grecian husband was something, to be a Grecian wife was just about a small notch above the cattle and others. They were abused. Many of the horrible sexual diseases that these men would catch would be brought home, and their wives were basically used for nothing other than another outlet of their sick minds. But coming to Jesus, began to see this unique relationship between the Church of Jesus Christ and our Father in Heaven as a marriage, as a wedding, as something that was intimate, something that was intended to be more than just using somebody, but rather opening your heart to serving and supporting and submitting a husband's life to his wife and the wife's life to her husband, and bringing up their children in seeing this gorgeous relationship between our Father and us, sending His Son to die for the sake of our union in eternity with Him forever. And so things began to change in the Corinth church. And it turns out that though they were working on a number of things, it seems that there was one thing that was quite desperate in those days. Chloe writes to the Apostle Paul, and he responds in chapter 5 with the astonishment that it seems the church has come to a place where they're quite comfortable with a prolonged series of incestuous acts between a son and his stepmother. He, I'm sure, was heartbroken, as I would be. Not that sin wasn't happening, or did happen, or that someone came into the church and this sin was happening and it was recognized by the church, and the church gathered around them to direct them to the power of God's word, the standard of the law, the heart of those that want to please Him through faith, and of course, the dedication, the declaration, as it were, personally, to say, I will no longer do that. I see that it is sin, and because of that, I will no longer commit myself to it. But that's not what was happening. It seems that it became not only well known, but it became something that people were all right with. Now, incest seems to be one of those things that is right up there with the most despicable things that could possibly happen. Any kind of sexual battery, any kind of sexual abuse today ranks among the things that break people's heart to the very core of their lives and affect them their whole lives. I've sat with men and women of all ages and wept with them about how they feel shame in things done to them. Not things that they did, but the things done to them, they feel such shame. Because perhaps they could have done something, they should have done something, at whatever age they were. You know that in almost every case, responding, defending, doing something was not possible. And so they bear that shame. They bear the hurt, the agony, the scars, the pain of something out of their control that, as many of you know, that perhaps have friends or family that have dealt with this, it's changed their lives forever. And so also in this church, we don't know the age of the boy, we don't know the age of the woman, but we do know that Paul declares, as it's discovered or perhaps announced or told him by this woman from Corinth, that this is not only happening in the church, but so far as to the point of that letter, nothing had been done. Nothing had been done. And you'll see that in this church, I suppose, to some degree, the elders or the pastors, and certainly Paul, being he who designed the very requirements of elders when he wrote to Timothy, in Ephesus, he said, here's the requirements of an elder. He knows how the men that have been called by God, ordained by God to be the leaders of this church, and certainly the pastor, are to be shepherds over a flock. that are watching for the wolves, watching for the things injecting themselves, the diseases, the things that might bring ruin within the flock, and suddenly you have nothing. But it seems as though this wolf has been not only not defended against, but actually in some degree just put up with. And Paul's horrified. He says, in the city of Corinth, this act, this sin, is not even named among the Gentiles, which means, in fact, the other people of Corinth wouldn't even go this far to do such sin. Oh, there's plenty of other sins that they would do. Plenty of other things that they would do for the sake of just living out some silly fantasy. But sex with a child, sex with your own child, impossible. He says, not even named among the Gentiles. And yet you as a church are doing nothing about this. Can't you see? This is the warning that he brings. And here's the connection to Passover, if you would. Here as we look at verse 6 of 1 Corinthians chapter 5. He says, do you know? Don't you realize that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Now to the people of Corinth, Grecians as it were, Hellenists, they're not really too interested in the subject or the idea of leaven, but to every Jew, and certainly this Christian church, like many of Paul's early churches, was born out of the synagogue. And in fact, this also was born out of the synagogue, and Sosthenes would later become an important part of that church, even named by Paul later on. And he was the head of the synagogue. And it seems as though this subject, as Paul relates the issue of the littlest compromise growing as a snowflake becomes an avalanche, to something that may have started within this church. Hey, pastor, have you heard that there's this rumor going around that in that household over there, that's the lady and that's the boy. Did you know that this is happening? I'm supposing at this point, things like that on occasion occur here. People will tell me, did you know that this is what's happening? Or do you realize? And I, with respect, don't necessarily each time pass it off as just silly rumor or the ugliness of gossip, but I pray that if someone brings something to my attention, they bring it for the purpose of helping to solve that issue. Because you see, if you're not a part of the problem and you're not a part of the solution, then you're just a busybody. You're just a gossip. And I wonder whether the pastor, hearing this rumor, this issue, thought, well, I don't know. I mean, here's the kind of things that are crossing my mind. Well, it's a family that sure gives a lot to this church. Oh, well, really? The husband there, he's one of our leaders, and maybe he doesn't even know how unlikely that would be. What's going on in his own household? I don't know what the excuse was, but there was some degree of compromise that led to the point where others knew outside the church, like Paul. Surely others in the church knew as well, and yet they did nothing about it. And Paul puts it in this way. To the Jews, at least, he says, listen, you realize, and many of you who bake bread know that it takes the littlest speck of yeast or leaven in a lump of dough that eventually that leaven, that yeast, will take over the entire dough. I heard many years ago that with sourdough bread in San Francisco, one of the ways that sourdough came about was that, in fact, ladies would put on the sill of their open windows a lump of dough. And there is so much sourdough yeast in San Francisco's air that it actually brought about the creation of sourdough bread, which, if you're like me, I sure enjoy. The point being that the littlest speck of yeast or leaven, in fact, leavens and brings yeast, puffs up the dough to the entire lump. And here's Paul's point. See, at Passover, for 7 days, a Jewish family reenacts the cleaning of the house. And this is, in fact, where we get the idea of spring cleaning. That during the week, they would do their best throughout their home, oftentimes dirt floors, get the idea, kind of adobe hut. But they would go about the house cleaning as much leaven, any kind of speck or dust throughout the entire house. This was spring cleaning. And then during the Passover Haggadah, the kids would actually take a moment to get a feather and a little spoon, and they would walk around the house and act like mom and feather the dust into the spoon. They bring back the spoon, and they would show, yes, Lord, I am concerned about leaven left in our house as well. Get the idea now. What the Lord was asking of the Jews was, in fact, to act out taking all sin, all leaven out of the house, out of their house, leaven being the representation of sin. And Paul says, and this is so appropriate to every one of us, because unless you've been a Christian just since this morning, you realize that there are certain sins that have such a desperate, intimate contact to you in your heart, that sin seeks to completely possess and rule your life. Thus, Paul saying, even a little leaven, if gone unabated, uncleaned, will eventually take over the entire lump. And that's why I've titled this morning, this sermon, Be a New Lump. I remember Beaver Claver had a friend that's name was Lumpy. Listen, we're all lumpy without the power of the Holy Spirit cleansing us. Now, see, here's the thing. Paul's saying, just as the Lord instructed us at every Passover to go throughout the house and clean every speck of leaven, isn't that, in fact, what the Holy Spirit requires of us as well? There's no room for the smallest piece of leaven, of sin, of compromise. And even so, this is how Paul begins to apply it to our lives as well. He says, listen, purge out the old leaven, verse 7 of 1 Corinthians 5. Purge out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us. Now, this needs to be a truth in us that we will never forget. That in fact, the sacrifice of Christ, Jesus, has washed you of all your sin. All your sin. Where do I connect this in the scriptures? 1 John 1:9. I repeat it so often. For if we confess our sins, He, Jesus, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all. All means all. In the Greek, all means all. Yeah, it's all. All of your sins. He's cleansed you of those sins. He has washed you of all unrighteousness. Simply put, if I just speak to Jesus concerning my sin, I agree with you, Jesus, that incest is absolutely and horrifyingly, putridly sinful. He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And imagine that. Imagine that. The Apostle Paul's struggle in Romans chapter 7 is with the issue of covetousness. Astonishing, not many of us would probably account as covetousness a possessing, addicting sin in our lives. But in fact, it was for Paul. What it really means is that any sin can captivate a person's life. Every great avalanche, and you noted in the news recently that at Everest, This happens so rarely. Huge avalanche, hundreds killed. Every avalanche begins with one flake of snow. Every avalanche. And you're intelligent people. You're smart. And by the way, this morning, you're awfully good looking. But all those attributes will not save you and your mind from contemplating a compromise with something that you might this morning consider to be pretty small. You might be considering this morning, well, you know, what I just did, that's not a big deal, because certainly that guy, as I look down the aisle right now, oh man, he's got real issues going on. Don't look around. Boy, if there's problems, he owns them. And in comparison to incest, you might think this morning, well, this whole section of Scripture doesn't apply to me. I've never done that. I couldn't possibly think of doing that. But the Apostle James, the epistle writer James, the half-brother of Jesus, wrote that if you fail in one portion of the law, you failed in all of it. That's something, isn't it? Romans 3:23 tells us that for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every one of us. To the degree that we begin to compromise with that sin or begin to live, as it were, fairly comfortably with that sin, Paul says, listen, you don't realize that sin left to itself will eventually attempt to absolutely possess you. And we might pass this off as saying, well, of course, those Corinthians, I know something about Corinth. And certainly I could say I know something about how that could happen there. But Santa Maria, you know, modern people, yes, friends. Yes, friends. The brothers, sisters, aunts and uncles, parents and grandparents, the children and the cousins of sin is more sin. And the wages of sin is death. And you may not think that by allowing sin in your life that in fact death is beginning to take over. But I want you to know, Christians, even in you, with the compromise or just comfortable lifestyle of allowing a sin in you, and you know what? You consider that a small one, considering those real sinners that are sitting near you. I can handle this. I'm in control of this. I can't tell you how many addicts have said to me, it all began by me thinking I could stop this at any time. It's not in control of me. I'm in control of it, little knowing that in fact it has the full control of your life. And will not stop there until it is as the devil seeks to completely ruin your life. Paul continues by saying this, verse 8. Therefore, let us keep the feast. What's the feast? It's the Passover feast. It's dealing with leaven. And Paul's application here is one that I think is fitting today because this is Passover. We've been celebrating the Feast of Unleavened Bread. We've been thinking in terms of what, you know, the Levitical law has encouraged us, as even as Christians, to do this week, to sweep out, to cleanse out, to consider our home as something that is in need of absolute cleaning. Friends, what more important thing to do on this Resurrection Sunday than have a spring cleaning of your spirit? Jesus says, listen, you need to go around every single corner, every closet, every piece of flooring, second floor, basement, everywhere you go, and look for where sin is hiding and rid yourself of it. Now, you might think that's a little, you know, I can't do that. It's going to cost me something. Absolutely. Imagine what it cost Jesus. I may have to admit something to someone. Praise God for that. There is such a great release with those you've harmed coming to them and saying, listen, it breaks my heart. I am so grateful that Bob Coy went to his elders. This means so much to me concerning him, that he told his elders, listen, here's what's been going on, and I can't live with this any longer. How important that would be this morning to say that to Jesus. Here's what's in my heart. Here's the compromise that's been happening. Pastor Paul doesn't need to know about this morning. But Jesus, you need to know. It's interesting that David, after his adultery with Bathsheba, and then the conspiracy and accounted as the act of murder against Uriah the Hittite, her husband, that he comes in Psalm 51 and he cries out to God, against thee and thee alone, O God, have I sinned. It is true, our sin is directly and initially against our God. Particularly when the Word of God, dear Christians, lives within our hearts. Jesus lives within your heart. The Word became flesh and dwelt among men, John chapter 1, verse 14. Jesus, the living Word of God, lives in your hearts. And how he desperately this morning calls upon you to get rid of all the old leaven. In other words, the old sin. Are you still the victim, you might put it this way? The victim of some addiction, the victim of some issue in your life that you've never taken the offensive against and said, Lord God, today on this Resurrection Sunday, I am taking the offensive against that which is seeking to gain utter control of my life. And I cannot live with it any longer. I've got to have you in every corner, every fashion of my life. Because you, Lord God, are my Passover lamb. You shed the blood. You cleansed my soul because you're faithful and just. And all that's been necessary up until this very day, dear friends, is just relieving yourself through that wonderful vehicle of the cross to say, Lord God, I'm giving up. I'm surrendering. I'm surrendering and submitting myself to you. Do I speak of you this morning? Are you, dear friend of God, somebody that has made compromises? Maybe you would describe them as small ones, but again, a single snowflake could end up being the avalanche of your life, your career, your family, your church. Jesus is calling upon you today. Would you see this with me in these scriptures? Jesus is calling on you today here at Passover to take out all the old leaven. Get rid of all the old sin. Leave it at the cross this morning. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life. And will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, senior pastor of Calvary Chapel.